Welcome everybody to Algebra 1AB. This is our final installment of our semester 2, I guess you could call it a mini-series, our review assignments here. So let's get right to it. We know what the test is going to look like. It's just time to kind of fine-tune those skills. Number 1 says to draw a box and whisker plot for the data that we have given here. I'm going to start off by making a number line and just scanning. It looks like my data set goes from a 2 up to a 24. So let's go ahead and count by 2s. I'll start with 2. 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24. Now, I'd already said this as I kind of fill in my numbers here. This is going to get crowded in a hurry. I shouldn't have put all these numbers in. But as I said before, you will not have to graph on your final exam. The idea here is by reviewing and making the entire box and whisker plot, we'll hopefully be ready to answer multiple choice questions on this, such as we saw in the last assignment, right, where we have to just find the third quartile or something like that. And, you know, I mean, there may be a question that says which of these box and whisker plots is correct or something like that. So we do need to know how to graph it, even if we're not going to have to fully graph one ourselves. All right, since we just made this number line going nice and in order, showing the range of our data, we're going to want to list out our data values in order. I'm just going to quickly check 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Let's go ahead and list out these 9 numbers from smallest to largest. Okay, so we got a 2, and it looks like 4, 5, 7, 8. 4, 5, 7, 8. Then we've got a 10, 13, 22, and 24. All right, let's just check and make sure we got all 9 numbers listed out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Very good. I know right away that the lowest number and the highest number, this 2 and this 24, will be a part of my 5-number summary. So I'm going to go ahead and plot those points right now. Because my list had 9 numbers on it, the perfect middle number will split the difference, and I'll get a lower half that has 4 numbers on it and an upper half that has 4 numbers on it. And if I split each of those halves right down the middle, I will find my first quartile and my third quartile. So let's not get ahead of ourselves. I'm doing too much too quickly. Here, this middle number, this 8 that we found, that is our median, and that is a key value on our box and whisker plot. That quartile 1 would actually be halfway between 4 and 5, so it would actually be a 4.5. And quartile 3 between 13 and 22 would actually be 17.5. Right there. Now, these two quartiles that we just plotted and the median get vertical lines through them because they make up the middle half of our data set. So that's the box portion, and then we extend the sides just with lines, creating the whiskers to go to our high and low values. There's our box and whisker plot. Again, those data problems, there was nothing really tough about them, but they did take some time to set up. Number 2, it says match the function with the graph, but it looks like we're not seeing any options A, B, C, or D. That's unfortunate. Let's see if we can't come up with what the function should be. This hopefully is something that we could do just by looking at these 3 points. So here, we've got 3 points emphasized. I'm just going to make a little table of what we do know. So I know that when x is 0, that we've got, well, I shouldn't put that up top. There's one that has a lower x value. Kind of want these to go in order if we can help it. All right, so I'll put 0 in the middle. I had a y value of 1. When x is negative 1, here I'm looking at this point right here, the height is halfway to 1, so that would be a y value of 1/2. And when x equals positive 1, my y value has a height of 2. All right, so what do I notice? Well, I notice that when I have a first power, the output is a 2, and when I have a 0th power, my output is a 1. With an exponential function, we're going to have y equals maybe something out front and then a base to the x power. So I just need to find these numbers a and b. All right, so let's see what happens when I have 0 and 1 and then 1 and 2. So it looks like we've got 2 and then 4. I'm just kind of looking for other points that come out cleanly. Maybe I can find a pattern here. 3 and then 8. Well, I noticed that my pattern as I move down the Y column is a times 2 over and over and over again. And so that leads me to believe that I've got Y equals A times, if I keep multiplying by 2s over and over again to get that pattern in my Y column, it must be a 2 as my base, because every time I raise up that power, I double my output. I'm multiplying in one extra 2. All right, and now I just need to figure out what the value for A is. Well, I know that when I plugged in a 0, let's just look at this one. When I plugged in an X value of 0, my output was a 1. So here, anything to the 0th power is going to be a 1, so A has to equal 1 as well. So my actual function is Y equals just plain old 2 to the X, or 1 times 2 to the X. All right, now this appears to be a misprint. I'm guessing that this was intended to have some ABCD options, just like the last review assignment that we did. So I apologize for that. Please be aware, though, that you will not be asked to do work like this on your final exam. Everything will be multiple choice, so you will have some options to kind of compare with. Problem number 3 and 4, we're naming by degree and the number of terms. Because this has 2 terms, it is a binomial. And because the highest power I see on a variable is a 3, this is a third degree binomial. For number 4, I've got 3 terms, meaning I'm working with a trinomial. Oh boy, trinomial. And the highest power I see on a variable is 4, so this is a fourth degree trinomial that we see. For numbers 5 and 6, we're finding the product. That's more practice with our FOIL method, since we're taking a binomial times a binomial. F, first times first. 7 times 8 is 56, x times x, x to the second. Outer, I've got 7x times 3, that is a positive 21 with an x multiplied in there. 2 times 8 is 16, and again, that had an x in it as well. Lastly, positive 2 times positive 3, positive 6. Final answer, 56x to the second. We can combine the two inside terms here in our product. Those are going to be like terms. We get plus 37x. And our plus 6 wraps things up. Number 6, another binomial times binomial. But this one has negative, so we do want to take some care here. Negative 6n times negative 1n. Okay, negative 6 times negative 1 is positive 6, n to the second. Outside, I mean, here's another negative times a negative. Negative 6n times negative 8. Negative 6 times negative 8 is positive 48, n times, well, there's no other n's multiplying in. Inside, a positive 2 times a negative n is negative 2n. And then last times last, negative 2 times negative 8. We really want to be careful when we're distributing or multiplying. There's so many negatives floating around. Just kind of talk yourself through it, kind of like I did here. When are you taking a negative times a negative? When are you taking a negative times a positive? Combine our like terms together and we get our final answer there. We should be pretty solid in FOILing at this point. I think it's been on every review worksheet so far. We've got 4 quick solve by factoring problems here. And it looks like we're dealing with a lot of lead coefficient 1, so that's really nice. The lead is 1, magic numbers and done. So for number 7, I just want to do a quick check. We are set equal to 0. That's wonderful. Because the lead is 1, I know I can go right into my factors, and it's going to have each factor open up with p. I want to find 2 magic numbers that will multiply to make negative 32 and add up to make positive 4. That is a positive 8 and a negative 4. Now again, that may take some searching to do, but hopefully we can find that no problem. Even if it takes a minute or so, it's worth it because the end of the problem is so much faster. Once I have my 2 factors established, I want to take each of them and set them equal to 0 on their own. We call this mini equations. And it should just be a quick step or 2 to solve from there. P equals negative 8. Add 4 to both sides over here, and we get our other solution, P equals 4. So our solution set would be P equals the set 4 and negative 8. And it could be in a different order. That doesn't really matter, but it's these two solutions. For number 8, same thing. Lead is one, magic numbers and done. I want to find two magic numbers that will multiply to make negative 8 and add up to negative 2. That one shouldn't be too hard to find. Negative 4 and 2 are those magic numbers. So p minus 4, p plus 2. Set up our factors. We've got many equations that we need here. Either that p minus 4 could equal 0 or that p plus 2 could equal 0. Either one of those would solve this equation. Let's add 4 to both sides and find that p equals 4. We'll subtract 2 from both sides over here and find that p equals negative 2. Our solution set, p equals the set that has positive 4 and negative 2. Problem number 9. Man, a lot of quick practice with magic numbers here for sure. Set up beautifully. Lead is 1, magic numbers, and done. I know my factors are going to open up with n and n. Let's find those magic numbers. What'll multiply to make a negative 16 but add up? Or sorry, multiply to make positive 16 but add up to make negative 10. Oh, man. Okay, 8 and 2. So when I find those magic numbers, negative 2 and negative 8, maybe do a quick check. Do they multiply to make positive 16? Okay, that's good. Do they add up to make negative 10? All right, that's good too. We're rolling, so we're going to set each factor equal to 0 on its own and solve. This is one area where we have seen just a tremendous amount of improvement out of our students, the ability to take a simple equation and just really dive right into those solving steps. So by the time we get to setting each of the factors equal to 0, we can really fly. So that's a props to you. That's some real growth as students with how quickly it's almost like second nature now. Number 10 is the only dark horse here because it is not a trinomial. So we're not going to be using magic numbers here. However, we will be taking a look at other methods of factoring, such as a GCF or a difference of squares. Now, because I don't have an x to the second, because 2 is not a perfect square number, GCF is really my only option, and I do notice that I can divide an x out of both of those terms and undistribute it, move it out front. All right, now in so doing, we do get two factors. One of them just looks a little bit different. It still makes a mini equation. I will set that factor of x equal to 0, and I'll also set this factor of x minus 2 equal to 0. The first one, thankfully, needs no further steps. It's already solved. So we got one of our answers right now. And the other, a quick adding 2 to both sides, and we find that x equals 2. So our answers for that are 0 and 2. That's our set of solutions. All right, next, 11 and 12, solve using the quadratic formula. Again, your formula sheet will have quadratic formula written, so this will be provided to you. And it's just up to us to make sure that we have everything set up to find the values of A, B, and C and plug into this quadratic formula. So let's see what we got for number 11. All right, we're in standard form. We're set equal to 0, so I can tell that A is equal to 5, B is also equal to 5, and C equals a negative 18. Let's get to work. Now we're not solving for X, we're solving for K. So I'm not going to use x equals, but k equals the opposite of b. So instead of positive 5, I'll put a negative 5, plus or minus the square root of that b value squared minus 4 times a times c. Ooh, and that is going to make a negative times a negative. Keep that in mind. All over 2 times a. Let's clean up that radical, that square root. 5 to the second is 25. A negative 4 times a 5 times a negative 18 makes a positive 360. And that's all over 2 times 5, which is 10. So I've got negative 5 plus or minus the square root of 385 all over 10. All right, and at this point, I would be checking my ABCD answers because we've simplified that radical down to a single number inside. Maybe this looks like some of our answer choices. Maybe it does not. So if not, we could try to tower that 385. I know I can divide by 5. So let's see what we get there. I'm actually just going to pull out a calculator for this. If I divide 385 by the prime number 5, I get 77. 77 is not prime, but I can divide it by the prime number 7. 77 divided by 7 is 11, and 11 is prime. So I noticed that I did not get any repetitions of numbers. That means I don't have any pairs that would leave this radical. This is, in fact, our final simplified answer. And if we were working on a multiple choice test, we would have known that. We would have even tried to tower because we'd have our answer already. Number 12. Okay, this one is not set up correctly. I want my trinomial set equal to 0, so I need to subtract 4 from both sides first. So r to the second minus r, this would make minus 72 equals 0. Now we'll go through the quadratic formula, but remember, if your ABCD answers are looking nice and clean, you may want to try something like magic numbers if you're feeling pretty good about solving by factoring. Clean answers that don't have radicals in them usually mean that we can do one of those easier, faster methods. All right, let's see what we got here, though. We're going to assume that we don't catch anything like that. A is 1, B is negative 1, and C is negative 72. So we'll set up our quadratic formula. We're solving for R, so R equals the opposite of B, that's a positive 1, plus or minus the square root of B squared minus 4 times A times C. Ooh, again, there's a negative times a negative, all over 2 times A. R equals 1 plus or minus the square root, let's see, negative 1 to the second turns that into a positive 1. Negative 4 times 1 times negative 72, let's see, we'd have 288. Yep, positive 288, all over 2 times 1, which is 2. And cleaning up the radical, R equals 1 plus or minus the square root of 289, all over 2. And again, I'll quickly check down in my answer choices. If they're coming out nice and clean, I probably got some simplifying that I can do. And 289 does end up being a perfect square number, but it's not one that we commonly see, especially not at the freshman level. R equals 1 plus or minus the square root of 289 is just 17, all over 2. And so, again, if our answers were coming out clean, maybe we'd try taking this square root in a calculator or something. You know, it's not too hard to see how it could simplify further. All right, so we've got two different options here. We could either be dealing with a 1 plus 17 divided by 2, or we could be dealing with a 1 minus 17 divided by 2. 18 divided by 2, my first path here, gives me 9, and negative 16 divided by 2 gives me an answer of negative 8. Those are the two solutions. So we come up with R equaling either negative 8 or 9. All right, and our final three problems of review, simplify using our properties of exponents. For number 13, this is all just a bunch of multiplication. So we got some coefficients, we got some base x terms or factors, and some base y factors as well. So I'm just going to group those. First, let's look at the coefficients. 2 times 3, those are regular numbers just multiplied in. I can just straightforward multiply those. 2 times 3 is 6. Then for my base x terms, I've got x to the negative 3rd and x to the positive 4th. I can combine those into a single base of x, and since it's not power to a power, I'm just going to add the exponents together. And we get x to the, well, negative 3 plus 4 is just 1. So 6x to the first, or just 6x. Then I have my base y terms. Well, there's just y to the second and nothing else to add to it. This one's done. So I believe in the last, or maybe it was two videos ago, I went through this process in a little bit more detail on one of our problems there. But it is possible, if you notice what combines and what doesn't and how it combines, it is possible to do this with very little to, well, no work shown. All right, number 14, we've got a complicated base, but it is just a product in here, 2 times u to the 0 times v to the 3rd, all to the 4th power. Now, I'm going to use what I imagine most students would see first, which is that 4th power applies to the 2 and the base u term and the base v term or factor. Let's see what we can do with this. So 2 to the 4th power, And then each of these becomes a power to a power in which I multiply the exponents. So I can keep my base of u, but its combined power will be 0 times 4. And for my base v, I'll have 3 times 4, a 12th power. Now, I'm probably not going to see anything show up in my answer options that looks like this, because I noticed that this base u has a 0 power on it. And remember, that just means like a times 1 instead of times another term in there, so or another factor in there. So my answer is really just 2 to the 4th v to the 12th. And we may see that show up in our ABCD options, but just remember, if we're not seeing 2 to the 4th show up, we can calculate 2 to the 4th power in our calculators. Since it has a number for a base, we can actually figure out what that number actually turns into. So we may actually be seeing something like 16 v to the 12th. Hopefully we'd be able to make that connection that, hey, I can use the calculator to clean this up a little bit further. And lastly, number 15, let's kind of split this up so we can see all of our coefficients and base x and base y, kind of like we did in 13. So I'm going to envision this as my coefficient in the top is just 1, coefficient in the bottom is 2. So there's my coefficient grouping. For base x stuff, I've got x to the negative first and x to the second in the denominator. And for my base y things, I've got y to the second in the numerator and y to the negative second in the denominator. I didn't really do any work here. I just kind of split it apart so that everything that is either a coefficient is all kind of grouped together, everything that has a base x is grouped together, and everything that has a base y is grouped together as well. All right, my next task, I noticed that I obviously want to get the base x things. I want to get them combined to be just a single base of x. Same thing with my base of y, and I'm going to handle that by dealing with these negative exponents. It's only these two pieces that have negative powers on them, so those are the only ones that get the reciprocal treatment to turn them into positive exponents. So let's see what our fractions look like now. I've got negative 1 over 2. Then I had x to the negative first in the top, but it left. It went to the bottom, so I just need a 1 to hold place. So it's now x to the positive first multiplied in with that x to the second that's down there already. Then I had y to the second in my numerator, but then I also brought up, using that reciprocal, y to the negative second. It moved to the top to get a positive exponent, and I just need a 1 to hold place. And now that I'm multiplying things with the same bases together, I can pretty easily tell that my numerator is going to have a 1 times, this is going to be y to the fourth. I'm going to add those exponents together. Again, it's not power to a power, so I wouldn't think about multiplying there. And then across the bottom, to connect these back up, I've got a 2 times x to the third, using that same idea, add the exponents here, times 1. My final answer is y to the fourth over 2x to the third when I clean up that multiplication. All right, everybody, so there you have it, 7 days of Algebra 1 second semester review. Man, I hope by the time we're getting to the end here, you're just like, okay, Mr. Hartz, I know what I'm doing. That's like the best feeling you can have going into a final, is that kind of confidence when this type of work is just so mundane because you know how to go about solving them. That's math confidence for sure. All right, best of luck to all of you on your final exams. I sure hope that this review process has helped prepare you.